mix it with Ghostbusters with zombies. I tell you, Evil Dead makes more sense than this. Yes, are you the owner of some book that I believe and hope to be bound in some sort of strange rubber? You left your phone number in it.
Oh yes, you're the poor mortal who I gave the temporary possession of that to.
Oh. In that case, why would you put such a powerful item in my hands?
Well, I am rather busy, and that book can become quite a handful, so I figured it needed a time out, and you seem were the closest one to me.
Yeah, about that. Say, oh, your book decides to infect an inanimate object like, oh, a DVD.
Did you let it come into contact with the book?
Maybe.
Ugh, mortals. Why do they always screw things up and give me more work?
Well, if that's the case, I'll just head over in a short bit with the disc.
Well, as you should know, magic does not come free.
Ah, what type of payment do you normally receive?
I always accept money. Unless you'd rather be my virgin sacrifice.
Can you excuse me for a second? Take debit.
Deal.
Heads, I return it immediately. Tails, I review it to the pleasure of my viewers out there who have been curious to know what is on this DVD. I guess I have no choice, do I? I look at something even more obscure than this. But no! When one starts the curiosity, they have to end it. I guess I better start with the 1980s and how they had that golden rule where if it was a toy, it had to be a TV show. Well, okay, not everything was formed into a half-hour Saturday morning show, but a good chunk of it was. But of all the ideas to make a toy into a kid show, none was the more stranger than that of Teddy Ruxpin. He's well regarded by many as the first actual robot toy, as one would play a tape through him and he would talk. He was a popular one, and many felt he had a creepy quality to it. Personally, I just don't get why one would be afraid of a talking bear with an emotionless face and talks in a monotone voice and... never mind then. Well, this talking teddy was so popular they had to make a TV show out of it. But not just any ordinary show! This was meant to be bigger than... Okay, bottom line here, the creator wanted to be in live action, they shot a 1-hour live action pilot, and instead it aired as Movie of the Week on ABC. Let's take a look. Well, this seems promising.
Let's go to far places, and
I bet you're wondering what this has to do with the plot. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. We just see it here, and it's never brought up again. The only assumption we can make is that it's Teddy Ruxpin's mother, judging from how she's holding up the actual doll. I mean, what looks like Ruxpin himself. And the lullaby she sang is the tune Teddy would normally sing. But seeing how we don't get to see her after this, the main focus is on that map and stone key, which will be put to better use. 15 years later.
You didn't tell me that adventure seeking would be this hard on my feet.
Yeah, Grubby. Octopedes do have a lot of feet to worry about.
Yep.
Where do I begin? First, it should be noted and quite obvious that this is entirely done in animatronics. Which is not a bad idea, but I feel someone seems to be borrowing from the Dark Crystal a bit too much. And while that proved to be quite successful in making a fantasy world appear very believable, what we get here is more of the cheap version, which at least came out 2 years after Jim's magnum opus. Here, the storybookish sets have some charm like something out of a Sid Marty Krofft show, but yet feel cheaper and poorly done. Still, it's ambitious and somewhat acceptable when you can consider the low-budget projects television had. But to compare, most of the crew after this went off to do two Disney shows, Welcome to Pooh Corner and Dumbo's Circus, which utilized the same mode of puppetry, but somehow looked improved. I guess it's because we are more familiar with those characters from their respective films, as opposed to placing two popular toys in an environment we are not 100% familiar with. And to add more confusion, Will Ryan, who voices Grubby, later went on to voice Rabbit, Tigger, and Eeyore in Welcome to Pooh Corner, which is very ironic as you can almost hear a hint of all three characters in his voice.
Are you sure those roots are edible?
Well, I don't know if they're edible or not, but they sure are good to eat.
It's like that game on Whose Line Is Anyway where two people have to sing a song in one voice. It's funny, but yet it's strange. And before we get back to the plot, I'd also like to add that we spend little time on these blue screen sets as we roughly get 30 seconds to a minute of time looking at them. I can understand it's probably for budgetary reasons, but the less we see of this world, the less time we'll have to enjoy it. And besides, if you're gonna go through all that trouble to make this great, strange, and new fantasy land, maybe better to take some time to get a good gander at it, as opposed to plowing right through it. Oh, and as for the plot, remember that half-broken medallion and that map from the beginning? Well, as it turns out, they're highly important for a treasure hunt.
Do you miss home, Annie?
Yes, I guess I do a little. But we've only been gone a few days.
Well, I know, but you're the first Iliop to leave Rolonia in a long time. And I thought you might be getting homesick.
It's true. Iliops aren't very adventurous. At least they haven't been for many generations. But somehow, I've always had this desire to go on a journey to Grundo. And I want to find out if this old map really leads to a treasure.
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention. Apparently Teddy Ruxpin is considered in his world an Iliop. I know, strange, isn't it? I guess there's certain types of bears that are called certain types of things depending on the towns they came from, but I digress. And besides, that's nothing compared to what we get to see next.
Hopping mouths!
Yeah, and them mouths are full of teeth!
Whoa!
Oh well, I'll give this pilot some credit. At least these creatures, or bounders as they're called, happen to be well-crafted and appear to be quite the nightmare fuel for kids. But still, these hopping mad monsters are prey to the easiest and dumbest of weaknesses.
Treacherous little bounders.
Wow! All it takes is one stick to put in their gaping jaws, and they flew away! Shame that nearly worked for the Rancor. So our two heroes are saved by a professor named Newton Gimmick. Go figure. As he offers them a visit to his home, as our two decide to let him in on the treasure hunt as well. And this is where I should raise another red flag on the depiction of human characters in this pilot. I can understand the cheap use of the sets, But you do realize you could be cutting costs more if you had real live actors instead of animatronic people. Was there not enough money for a makeup crew? Well, either way, the idea of having animatronic people as opposed to actors just seems weird to me. It's like the choice of using motion capture for most of Robert Zemeckis films. It's off-putting, and makes one wonder why they didn't hire real actors and just went with artificial ones. Still, at least it wasn't creepily designed to look like these freaks. Still, at least the villain will be entertaining, right? Well, not quite.
Be quiet. I'm sure I've got the right combination this time.
Tweed, the closest you've ever come to making gold is a buttermilk donut.
LB, how many times do I have to tell you? The name is Tweeg. Tweeg.
Ah, yes. The never-ending cliche of mispronouncing the character's name. Huh. That'll never get old. Right, Jazoo?
Gazoo.
In all seriousness, Tweeg tends to be one of those antagonists that has some really poor actions. They're not gratuitously evil, just ridiculous and silly. I can understand that's probably the point considering how this is meant to target the younger crowd. But would you consider this action truly diabolically villainous?
Just think. To actually make gold out of buttermilk!
Hey, Tweez, your gold is getting stale.
Okay, that part about trying to get gold is fine. But thinking basic cooking ingredients will create such a substance? That I find weird. To compare, the Ernest series had Dr. Otto, which was also a villain with silly motives like creating a toaster that makes burnt breakfast. I know the guy's idea was to make people miserable with the smallest of annoying things. But hey, at least he was trying to do bad in lame ways. What's that? Still think there's hope of him being a badass? Ho 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 ho! I wish. Get this. He thinks Gimmick is planning to steal his buttermilk gold method, constantly fires a cannon at him from his high castle, and the cannonball lands only a few feet away from the house and has inscribed "Return to Tweeg" written on it. This is so bad, it's not even funny. And again, I know this villain's meant to be silly and stupid, but there's a fine line where that stupidity can overrun its course. Just pray to God this guy doesn't have a YouTube channel. But hey, at least he does some damage, though not a lot. His minion overhears the treasure hunt talk and gets Tweeg invested enough to search after it. But first, they need the map, which is conveniently and literally placed in his mouth, thus giving Tweeg the advantage of switching the real McCoy with a false one. Simplistic, yet genius, I will admit. That is, if Gimmick didn't pop it into the Bounder's mouth in the first place. Did he even think twice before putting it into the creature's jaws? We're already 10 minutes into this, and we have yet to come across the dumber moments. Still, I will give Gimmick credit for creating a mode of transportation. Besides, it was at least thoughtful to have a homemade hot air balloon.
It's not a balloon! It's an airship!
Oh, I'm sorry.
All right, go and have a look!
No, I'm fine here, thank you.
I didn't think I was going to use that clip again. But lo and behold, as they run into a tree, here comes another character that has some undeveloped characteristics, and played by a human?
My name is Leota.
I'm pleased to meet you, and I'm sorry if we've damaged your tree.
Oh, that's all right. Is there anything I can do to help?
Well, I'm not sure.
Something about this perplexes me. You have a human professor that is 100% human. And you have him portrayed by an animatronic puppet. And now, you finally use real actors. But only for this character? What the hell are they thinking? If your choice was to make this all-out animatronic, how come Tinkerbell over here is played by a real person and not some robot reject from the Rock of Fire explosion? Again, we have yet to get across the dumber moments, and yet stuff like this keeps getting in the way. So after she helps them make some adjustments to the ship, they fly over, and it's not long till they realize their map has been swapped once they find themselves in what I have to think looks like the Deadly Desert from Return to Oz.
And look, it says the treasure is buried in the Great Desert.
Oh, the Great Desert. Well, my bad on... Seriously? The Great Desert? Oh, sure! And 50 miles from that is a white castle, just right next door to the Great Valley! Oh, what a treat that will be! If geographical locations were enough, wait to hear the name given to these creatures that capture them when they try to find a fuel source for their airship.
They're mudblups.
That's right, mudblups. Mudblups. And just when I thought Bounders were starting to take the cake. To be fair, they do look more like a cross between the cavity creeps and the rock biters to me. Anywho, Gimmick and Teddy are sentenced to prison for no apparent reason, but I can think of a few. And come across a prince named Aaron, who looks more like a knight than one of great royalty to me. What's his story, you ask?
Well, my sister, Princess Aruzia, was kidnapped and taken from our land. I'd been searching for her when I was captured by these horrid mudblops. They captured me with ease. I'm a failure and a coward.
Just because you couldn't fend off those brutes, mudblops, you called them?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that doesn't make you a coward by any means.
Blame the people who wrote this plot device that came exactly out of left field, which will have no connection at all other than being conveniently connected to our journey.
Seriously, since when did we go from a treasure hunt to saving a princess? And speaking of convenience, thanks to a cave-in they managed to escape, blind a few mudblubs with bright light. Insert joke about how Gremlins did that cliche before this pilot appeared here. Save Grubby and decide to put greedy matters aside to save Aaron's sister. But our travelers get parched as they land and come across another creature called the Woolly Whatsits, which is the stranger of the bunch, which can only be described as a giant thneed from the Lorax that got possessed by Yukon Cornelius.
Hey, you! Get out of there!
What did you say?
Well, we gotta be off on our mission to find Princess Aruzia, and, well, you're holding us up.
Go on! You say a princess?
I never knew this place was under such royalty, considering how undeveloped the special has been, and the fact that my brain is made of cotton candy!
Either way, the woolly whatchamacallabar decides to help him as he wishes to see a real princess and takes him to a wizard for... wait a minute... a man longing for logic with his inventions, a man dressed in tin that is heartily sensitive, a giant furry creature that shows little cowardice, and now a wizard. I'll believe it when I see it.
Who presumes to disturb the solitude of the wizard?
You had to go that route, didn't you? But give them some credit. We do get to see the wizard outside of the curtain for once. But he is more of a humbug than elf rank bombs when we really learn how his powers work.
Hey, Louis.
Yeah?
Have we got any footage on a Princess Aruzia?
I don't know. What does she look like?
Well, probably like her brother sitting out there.
Let me see him. Yeah, here she is, with the Katangs. I wondered what she was doing with them.
Well, according to her brother, she's been kidnapped.
Really? Well, this information ought to be worth something.
This Hogwarts harebrain is even more pathetic! You mean to tell me this termite of a snoop goes around, films random stuff in various geographical places, and uses it for a con? There are one too many flaws with this, but the biggest one I must address is having technology in a fantasy-like setting. Having a monarchy with kings and queens in a world like this, I can believe, but the presence of late 19th century technology kills all believability. I know this is meant for kids! But it just doesn't add up! It's like having Nikon cameras in the Stone Age. If it doesn't belong in that era, then what the hell is it doing there in the first place? Still, our heroes learn from the big bearded phony that the princess was kidnapped by a batch of creatures called the Gatangs. That just so happens to be where the treasure Teddy and Grubby are looking for is placed there. And speaking of which, Tweeg and his bounder minion appear right on the spot, but are having some difficulty.
Well, we've only been trying to climb these mountains for 2 weeks. Haven't you had enough yet?
Oh, all that treasure up there, and I can't get at it.
And I realize that if I remove my ears, I look like a Ninja Turtle. Seriously? They've been there for 2 weeks and have yet to climb up it successfully? No wonder why these guys are given little attention. Luckily, they jump on a gimmick-slanted ship in the nick of time as it lifts to the tippity-top of the long-lost city. As Tweeg sneaks off to find the gold, our band of misfits pull another Wizard of Oz cliché and save Arryn's sister. But before they run off, Teddy discovers where and what the treasure really is.
Look, it fits perfectly. Only the pure of spirit may find the treasure of knowledge.
Stones. Just stones that symbolize their personal traits? Kind of clever, but I digress. And before you can even question why they didn't take the random treasure that appeared in the room to Tweeg's liking, we have to get that answered after a big and cheap dogfight with the Gatangs once they find out the princess has escaped.
Put a spoonful of the stew right in this sling!
Good shooting, Teddy. You got him!
They're going to launch more planes!
This is starting to make the model work in 1941 seem more Oscar-worthy. And to be fair, at least that is more worth your buck than this Sid and Marty Krofft stage fight scene. But don't worry, everyone's favorite pink Wookiee comes in to save our heroes.
No!
It is here I would do a comical joke where I'd feel sorry for the guy and then feel relieved and glad that he's alive. That is, if I didn't have to question why fade to black there. Either way, Wooly survives to everyone's delight, and we get our answer to what the rest of that treasure they left behind was, and the purpose of those radioactive rocks.
Only the pure of spirit may find the treasure of knowledge. It's as though whoever left this message wanted us to take these crystals. And I think that what we will learn from these crystals will make all that treasure look like just an illusion.
I'll believe it when I see it.
What? Where did it go?
So let me get this straight. Those who truly discover the treasure of knowledge, the basic matter that they truly desire, is seen as a mere illusion? Ugh! That's the equivalency of Ted Turner taking over Schoolhouse Rock! Still, at least it's not as bad as...
The dreams you see most clearly are most likely to come true.
That. Bottom line, Teddy Ruxpin's live-action pilot is bad. Really, really bad. Well, not bad enough to be considered the worst idea for television, as I've seen others not worth mentioning. The idea of making nearly every character an animatronic puppet is kinda strange. I know the Dark Crystal was all a puppet, but what made it work was how there were little humans running about and more alien creatures. Teddy Ruxpin is a combination of that. So maybe it would have been better to have some real people than ones who were mechanical. And while I can't be too negative on the technical work of the puppets, as radio-controlled suit technology was new in the 1980s, I feel the attention was more on special effects and not enough on characters and plot. And to make a fantasy world seem lifelike within a span of 50 minutes feels rushed at times. Maybe if it was made more into a 90-minute movie, it would have probably given us a better understanding of the world Teddy lives in and how it works. Instead, the final result is a confusing mess that feels more like a Disney attraction people would go through once and forget about as they walk over to the next one. And sure enough, after the pilot took its course, got created, and nobody invested into it because of the high costs, it was then decided not to waste such an opportunity, and instead let it be seen in animation. And I can't believe I'm gonna say this, but it's actually better than the live-action adaptation. While the animation itself isn't that spectacular, we get to spend more time in the strange yet ambitious world that Ruxpin lives in while having much more development time on the characters. And setting these things up only took the first 5 episodes. 5 episodes! So the moral of the story today, my dear viewers, is that when you have an idea, think twice about what medium it could be suited for, or else you'll be in the same boat as Robert Zemeckis and his motion capture escapades. But that, my dear children, is another story for another day, because I have to get rid of this infected disc. Oh, voicemail!
Yes, seeing as how you said that it was a DVD that my book caused a possession of, I wouldn't do any movie reviews if I were you.
I don't know about you, but I'm getting out of here. Quick decision.
Freedom! Yeah.